Morning, church. Let's stand and sing to our Savior.
Good morning. Welcome to Allen Bible Church. We're glad that you are here to worship with us. If you're on site or if you are with us online, we want to welcome you as well. The ones online, you didn't have to take an ark to the building like we did. That was quite a storm this morning. If you're online, maybe you just woke up and didn't realize that. We are glad that you're here to worship with us. That's a great day. Glad to have Eric back with us. So thank you and team for your preparation. And again, if you weren't with us in-house last week, just want to thank all those who are working hard to make sure we can not only do this here safely, but as well to enable our body to join us online. So let's thank them again just for their work in doing that. AllenBible.org is where you can go if you've prepared to give as part of your worship. You can do that at any moment this morning or today. You can also still mail checks to our office, but would encourage you, there's no collection of offering right now in-house. In a few weeks, we may change that, but for now, would encourage you to go to AllenBible.org/give for that. Our website's also where you can find out what's coming up. There is a lot now that we are beginning to move forward and be creative and do some things to get together, both as adults, as kids, as students. You can find out a lot on our website there. Two that I want to highlight. One is Wednesday night. It's Popsicles in the Park with our Kids Life, that's kindergarten through fourth, and our 56 PMers, fifth and sixth graders, with their parents. Let me repeat that, with their parents. That'll help us make it a safe environment. We're going to be outside at the park. We'll have popsicles. Be a great way to meet some of your kids leaders, and Grant McKay, our kids director, is also parents, where he'll share what's coming up. I think you'll love hearing some of what he has planned for our kids, both in terms of safe fun, but also in terms of getting in God's word together. And then lastly, I want to highlight our marriage night coming up September 12th for adults. This is an adult-only evening. There will not be childcare here, just for obvious reasons, all that we're flexing and dealing with these days. But what a great opportunity to take advantage of. This is a live stream one-night event that right now media, marriagenight.org, are putting on. We're going to join thousands of couples from other churches across the nation. And so I want to encourage you, we will send you a link on Tuesday to begin signing up so that you can sign up through this host site, and we'll give you more info there. I just want to give you a little taste. You can see the speakers there. I just want to encourage you, particularly husbands, take the lead. This is a great date night. This is a way to let your wife know, I want to invest in us. And so husbands, I want to give you that challenge. Wives, if they need it, kick them in the pants. But let's look to get here together to be encouraged. I want to show you just a quick trailer as a foretaste of that, and then I'm going to lead us in prayer. You may have a seat, by the way.
Right Now Media's Marriage Night is back. On September 12th, join thousands of couples around the country for a one-night live stream experience. Laugh, learn, and grow with your spouse as you hear from marriage experts Les and Leslie Parrott, Matt and Lauren Chandler, Conway and Jada Edwards, and comedian Michael Jr. Visit marriagenight.org to get your tickets today.
Again, look for an email coming Tuesday with more on that. Would you go with me to the Lord in prayer? Heavenly Father, we praise you for what we've sung right before this, of your amazing grace, that you're a God of all grace and mercy, and that we can only have a relationship with you because of that. And so all of today, may that again be the word about Christ richly dwelling within us as your body, as your family. And Lord, I pray for the families of this church that you really would strengthen us. These are crazy times. There's hostility. There's hurt. And Lord, we pray that that we as families would move toward one another and not in isolation, that couples, Lord, we pray that an event like this would strengthen the marriages, which would strengthen the home, which would make more vibrant our radiating Christ to our neighbors. And that's what we desire to be, is you've called us your ambassadors among our neighbors, the nations, and the next generation. And Lord, these are nutso times. And we admit that often we feel like we're just wandering around and aimless and lonely. Thank you, God, that you know us. You know our frames. You know, and you're mindful of us. And we thank you that you come close. I pray that your nearness would be real to us this week. And I pray truly for our country, Lord. We are coming apart at the seams, and pray that we as your church would find our allegiance first and foremost to you, and not positions, and Lord, that we would see everyone created in the image of God, and that we would reach out, that we would radiate Christ's love, that we would see one another as you have made us. And Father, we pray what Jesus taught us to pray, that your will would be done in our patches of earth as it is in heaven. As to that end, Lord, even today, may your will be done. May your desire for our hearts to draw near to you in worship, may that be done, and may we benefit from it. Be glorified today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand.
Rumors of the Son of Man, stories of a Savior, holiness with human hands, treasure for the traitor. No ear has heard, no eye has seen of the Father, until heaven came to live with me, a rescue like no other, and you are worthy, you are worthy. Yeah. my place. Jesus, no other name. And only Jesus, no other name.
Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus. We thank you. We have righteousness, God, through your son, that you love us, that you've rescued us, that your mercy, your kindness, your grace, your love are abundant and unfathomable. I pray, God, that you would help us today. Help us to see you for who you are. Help us to trust you in all things, no matter what happens in the world around us, God, the chaos, the hurt, the pain, the grief. God, help us to be those that love. Help us to be those that see. Help us to be those that care. Help us be those that are light, your light, in this world. We love you, are grateful. We're grateful for just breath and life today, God. Thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Thank you again, worship team, and it is great to hear you singing. I don't know if it's because we've been mic'd a little, but great to just hear singing, isn't it, in person. In our series, Questions Jesus Asked, we're discovering that Jesus' questions open our eyes to God, or they may gently cause us to confront what's really going on in our own hearts. And today's question is Jesus' most haunting question. Why have you forsaken me? As we look in our text in a moment, you'll notice that I haven't given the full question. The full question lets us know to whom the question is raised, to whom Jesus voices his anguished question. It's also important for us to know when and where Jesus shouted this question in a loud voice. I want to take us there now. The scene is Golgotha, which is the hill of the skull. If you've ever wondered why we call it Calvary, evidently Calvary means the same thing in Latin, the hill of the skull outside of Jerusalem. I'm assuming a very imposing, gruesome sight, and it was so because it was the place of execution as well. And between noon and 3 in the afternoon is where our scene is. If you want to turn with me in your copy of God's Word in Mark chapter 15, or if you're joining us online on the website, there's a link to this passage, Mark 15. Turn with me and now pick up with me in Mark 15, beginning in verse 33. When the sixth hour came, that's noon for us, darkness fell over the whole land until the ninth hour, that's 3. At the ninth hour, 3 p.m., Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they began saying, "Behold, he's calling for Elijah." Someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave him a drink, saying, "Let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion, this Roman soldier, the centurion who was standing right in front of him, saw the way that he breathed his last, he said, truly, this man was the Son of God. Now, it was around 3 p.m. as he's hanging on the cross, Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some would say that it's even best to say it this way, my God, why me have you forsaken? He cries it in a loud voice. The original is where we get the idea of a megaphone. Imagine, he's already been on the cross for close to 6 hours now. That back shredded, pushing up against splinters. You have to push up just to breathe. And in a loud voice, he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? So, it's important to know to whom Jesus asked his most haunting question. What we know is that this is not a, he's not saying, why have you forsaken me, to doubting Thomas or to denying Peter or to betraying Judas, but to God the Father. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, from eternity past and for all eternity, in perfect love and unity of fellowship. And it's to him, God the Father, he says, why have you forsaken me? Now, to frame up our brief time today, I want to ask why. Number one, why did Jesus ask this? And number two, why does it matter to us? First, why did Jesus roar this question to God the Father? Because that's really the probably the best description. If you've ever heard a lion, almost like from the depths, this guttural roar. That is the idea that Jesus, from his guts, roars, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's important, when we're asking why did he say it, it's important for us to know that these are the exact first words of Psalm 22, a psalm of David, a psalm of messianic expectation. These are the exact first words, and there are at least three other portions in Psalm 22 that are peppered throughout the accounts of Jesus' death in the Gospels. Listen to these. First, verses 1 and 2. My God, why have you forsaken me? Far from deliverance are the words of my groaning. Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer. And by night, but I have no rest. Or verse 7. This is now talking about the surroundings, which we read a little hint of here, but we see it above and in other Gospels. Verse 7 in Psalm 22. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking or wagging their heads. Verse 16. They pierce my hands and my feet. Verse 18. They divide my clothes among them, and they cast lots for my garment. Why did Jesus cry out with this question? First, because it fulfills Scripture and God's plan for salvation. God's plan from eternity past for salvation. Jesus wasn't agonizing on the cross thinking, okay, what's a Bible verse I can throw out there? He was not. And I'm not trying to make light of that. What I'm saying is this was in him, knowing his identity, as it says in John, knowing that his time had come, right? He loved his disciples to the end, and then in chapter 18, knowing they were coming, he says, I know, he knew why they had come, and he gave himself up. Why? Because it fulfills Scripture. Jesus knows that Psalm 22 is all about him and what that he would endure. I like that John Piper says Psalm 22 is God's script for Jesus' final hours. It's his script. Jesus knew that God the Father had scripted for him ahead of time. This is what the Father had appointed for him, and he willingly, resolutely, Luke 9:51, he resolutely, for the joy set before him, endured the suffering of the cross. So first, why is because it fulfills Scripture and that script that God had for Jesus, and he knew it. Why else did Jesus cry out, why have you forsaken me? Well, I want to say this. Jesus isn't theologically curious. Okay, he's in agony. He's not asking to get the right answer, but to express soul anguish, to express the horror that he is experiencing, the soul anguish that's coursing through him. It's got to get out as he is experiencing real abandonment. He's really being forsaken. This isn't, again, not just to not quote a verse, this isn't to say, well, I got to put on a good show here, I'm fine. He's experiencing physical pain, but more than the physical pain, he's experiencing the excruciating pain of abandonment, real abandonment, from the one he's never been apart from. If some Allen Bible member comes up to me, says, buddy, I'm done with you, or I'm done with this place, and walks away, that would sting. But way worse would be if my wife says, I never want to see you or talk to you again. That would be excruciating. The longer the love, the deeper the love, the greater the ache and the torment of being forsaken. And that is what Jesus is really experiencing. We get really nervous to think about him having emotion because we know how we're lousy with our emotions. But Jesus has emotion. And that emotion wells up. And he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Well, the third why is God forsook his son because sin's penalty had to be paid. Forsook or forsaken means to desert. Not what I like to eat at Cheesecake Factory, but desert, to leave out, to leave alone, to leave for dead, if you will, to be abandoned. This was the greatest suffering for Jesus on the cross. For the Father to turn his face away. We sing how deep the Father's love for us. But when he's speaking of the Father and the Son, he's the Father turns his face away. That's what is happening here. Now, judicially, the Father separated from the Son. This is fellowship broken. He's not abandoning him forever. But this is fellowship broken. Why? Because at that moment, God was causing my sin, your sin, the sin of all time, to be laid on Jesus. And then, because Jesus now has sin, he's become sin, God pours out his wrath on Jesus, his son, so that sin's penalty would be paid. Jesus took our place. We just sang it. You stand by my side, but you stood in my place. It's a place I should be. It's a place you should be because of our sin. Jesus took our place to bear our sin, to die the death that we should have died. 2 Corinthians 5:21, Paul writes, he made him who knew no sin. He was sinless to become sin or to be sin, to embody sin on our behalf. There it is again, in our place, in your place. To be sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. And then Isaiah 53:4-6. Listen to the prophet's picture of the suffering servant. He says, surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging, we are healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Why does he cry out, my God, my God? Why have you forsaken me? Because it fulfilled Scripture. Also because it was real abandonment, and that real abandonment was necessary because payment for sin was necessary, and Jesus embodied my sin and yours. He bore our sins in his body, says in 1 Peter, so that in him we might have life. Well, that's why Jesus cries out, "Why have you forsaken me?" Well, why does that matter to us? Well, because Jesus was forsaken for our sakes. I confess, I kind of knew what sake meant, for our sake. We say that, you know, we'll say for goodness sake or for your sake or mine. But I never really, and I looked it up, and it's like for your benefit, for your well-being, for your advantage. He disadvantaged himself. He gave up his advantages. He gave up his life for you and for me for our sake, because he was forsaken for our sakes. His horrific abandonment fulfilled Psalm 22. But again, as he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He's not curious as to how this all is going to end up. He knows. The psalm begins with agony, but it ends with victory or triumph. Listen to the end of Psalm 22. I will tell of your name to my brethren. This is Jesus. I will tell of your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him, glorify him, stand in awe of him. For he has not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, nor has he hidden his face from him. But when he cried to him for help, he heard. Yes, the Father turned his face for a moment. But even in the end, these aren't Jesus' last words. We'll get to those in just a moment. Anguish in the psalm becomes victory. And anguish becomes victory in our passage as well. Verse 37, Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. This is most likely when Jesus shouted, "Tetelestai, it is finished, paid in full." And then, continuing to trust the Father, he says, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." Well, how does the Father respond? Verse 38, look there. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. In case we were wondering how it happened, from top to bottom. And the verbiage there is actually passive. Nobody else did it. The veil didn't do itself. There was an active, someone else being active, tearing it from top to bottom. It was God showing approval for Jesus' sacrifice, and that sacrifice was a once for all. The ones that had happened in that place before had to keep happening. But now Jesus' once for all sacrifice has given us a new and living access. That veil is what separated the Holy of Holies from the rest. And no one dared enter that unless you were in a good standing with God. And only a very few could do that. And you had to do it God's way. But now God is saying, because of what Jesus has done in your place and mine, he has granted us, as Hebrews 10 says, a new and living way, a new and living access to God the Father through Jesus. Also, why does this matter? Why does it matter that Jesus was forsaken for our sakes? Well, because we can also know that in our loneliness, that Jesus knows that feeling. He knows that feeling to its most agonizing depth. And he hurts with you when you feel lonely, when you ache. In fact, I would say right now, some of us maybe need to hear that most of all. We have a son who's a freshman at college, and not only do we ache for him, we ache for all college students, because it's a weird time. And what I'm afraid we're going to see, and this is just that sample, I think we're going to see a widespread depression amongst college-age students. Why? Because there's just so much isolation. You go to a place, but then you can't experience the place. You can't get out with the people. And that has wear and tear. And there's good news in this today, that Jesus understands that ache, that Jesus knows what it's like to be lonely. I came across this week. Why have you forsaken me? It was alone the Savior prayed in dark Gethsemane. Alone he drained the bitter cup and suffered there for me. It was alone the Savior stood in Pilate's judgment hall. Alone the crown of thorns he wore, forsaken thus by all. Alone, alone, alone upon the cross he hung, forsaken thus by all. Alone upon the cross he hung, that others he might save. Forsaken then by God and man, alone his life he gave. Alone, alone, he bore it all alone. He gave himself to save his own. He suffered, bled, and died. Alone, alone. Isaiah 53, part of it I didn't read, but lets us know that he knows right where you are if you feel alone, if you're hurting. Calls him a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. In our readings this week, if you're reading through our church-wide reading plan, came across for me what was an oasis. Psalm 68 talks about God knowing affliction and difficulty and all that. Then it said in verse 6, God makes a home for the lonely. How can he do that? And how could he appoint that home for us in a way that would feel like home? It's because he's acquainted with loneliness. He knows what it's like to feel abandoned to its achiest abandonment. And because he was forsaken, we can be forgiven of our sins and have an eternal home with him if we respond to him by faith in Jesus, just like the man who watched the way Jesus breathed his last. Look at verse 39. The Roman centurion, who could probably smell the blood and vinegar-soaked breath of Jesus, who was that close. We have our passion plays, and the cross is way up high. The cross was probably, you know, like here to here. And it says that the centurion saw how Jesus breathed his last, and he said, truly, this was the Son of God. What did he see? How did he see Jesus breathe his last? Have you ever seen someone take their last breath? I have. I have been even closer than the centurion to Jesus. To watch someone take their last breath lodges in your memory. It attaches to your soul. It disrobes all our facades. It exposes how fragile we are. It can cause us to think. What can we see that the centurion saw when he saw how Jesus breathed his last? Well, first, verses 20 to 23, he saw that Jesus refused to numb his pain. Jesus refused a merciful narcotic they were willing to give him so that he could drink fully the cup of God's wrath. He wanted to ensure that he had all of his faculties. And he refused to numb his pain, even when his pain was undeserved and it was excruciating. You and I aren't called to drink that cup of God's wrath. Jesus already drank it dry. Also, verses 24 to 32, the centurion saw that Jesus refused to save his own skin by enduring rather than escaping the cross. Even when innocent, yet taunted, he didn't come down. He didn't save himself. Jesus taught his disciples and us to take up our cross, not come down from one. And lastly, the centurion saw amazing restraint when he didn't come off the cross, but he saw Jesus refuse to distrust the Father. Even when forsaken in his final 3 hours, Jesus refused to distance, to disown, to distrust God the Father. He refused to curse God and die. He refused to give up on God the Father. And because of that, God says he will not refuse anyone who comes to him simply by faith, just like the centurion, believing Jesus is the Son of God and is the place taker that you and I needed, bearing your sin and mine on the cross. And we simply must believe and trust him as Savior. I want to ask the worship team to come up. It's a pretty sober passage. Like I said, this is the most haunting question of Jesus, because it's to God the Father saying, why have you forsaken me? But as we move to a time of the Lord's Supper, I want us not to just remember his death intellectually, but to embrace the one who died there for you and for me in your place. Jesus asked, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was again expressing agony, not needing an answer. A Cademan's call song years ago included this clever turn of phrase, my God, why have you accepted me? That clever turn of phrase fits because the only way that God could accept you and me is because God forsook his son. And Jesus was forsaken for your sake and mine. So that's why when we come to the Lord's Supper, it reminds us of the bitter cup of God's wrath, reminds us of his life broken for you and for me. But it's not just one of remembering bitterness, but also the sweetness that is ours, that he's a God who understands, that he's a God of mercy and grace. Now, you've got these prepackaged kits, or at home, you've got it easier. I want to encourage you to try to peel that back. There's a wafer in the top. There's a juice in the bottom. These remind us, these are pictures of what we'll come up partake in a moment, his body and blood. But don't partake yet, but as you're holding those, we're going to sing of Jesus' death in your place and mine, and then I'll come up and lead us in partaking together.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other found I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus, and nothing good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other found I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
He's all our hope and peace, amen.
And these tears, oh, my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And these tears, oh, my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. can make me whole again. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Jesus said, "This is my body broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." Let's partake together. He also took the cup. Talked about it being the blood of the new covenant. He said, "This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." Let's partake it with joy. Jesus, we thank you that you died so that legally we would no longer face condemnation because we are in Christ Jesus. But Lord, you have also redeemed us for a life worshiping you, serving you, a life of purpose, a life of redeeming us day by day from shame, from humiliation. But also you have brought us to yourself, and you tell us that you're a faithful high priest. You've gone through everything we have to the nth degree and yet without sin. And so you know what it feels like to feel lonely, to be anxious, to ache. And you are so gentle, so humble in heart. We find rest in you because you are willing, joyfully willing to take our place. We give you praise and thanks now. Be glorified in our lives as we leave this place, as we go about our day. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as a benediction, Jesus was forsaken so that you and I wouldn't be. So go in this assurance today from Hebrews 13:5. He himself has said, "I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you." The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Thank you for coming. We're going to dismiss by rows in a reverse wedding deal. Father and mother.